Hi, it's Isaac here. Today I'm continuing our tutorials on principles of consolidation. I am looking at intra-group transactions. Intra-group transactions. Now, parents and subsidiaries may be trading among themselves. Parents may sell goods to subsidiaries, and subsidiaries may also sell goods to parents. Parents may transfer assets to subsidiary, and subsidiary could also do likewise by transferring assets to parents. Now, what we need to appreciate is that anytime parents and subsidiary transact among themselves or between themselves, in the individual financial statements of each of them, they are going to recognize those transactions. So, for instance, if parent is selling goods to subsidiary, parent is going to recognize the sale of the goods as part of its regular sales. When subsidiary buys goods from parents, they are also going to recognize those goods as part of their regular purchases. In their individual financial statements, each of these transactions is going to be stated as a regular or normal transaction. We don't have any issue until we come on to consolidating. The reason why we have issue when we come on to consolidating is that On consolidation, we are looking at parents and subsidiary put together as though they are a single unit. If parents and subsidiary are put together as though they are a single unit and we are calling them a group, then the group cannot transact among itself, or the group cannot trade with itself. If that is what is happening, then we are going to eliminate all intra-group transactions. The reason why we are eliminating intra-group transactions is because the group represents parents and subsidiary. If parents and subsidiary are put together, so this is parents, this is subsidiary, we put the two together and we are calling them group. And this group is treated as a single entity. So if the group is being treated as a single entity, then the group cannot sell goods to itself. Neither can the group purchase goods from itself. So on consolidation, all such intra-group transactions will need to be eliminated. The reason why we have to eliminate is that if we sell to ourselves and we add it to our turnover, at the end of the day, we are going to inflate our turnover. If we buy from ourselves and we add it to our purchases, at the end of the day, we are going to inflate our purchases. So anytime there is any such intra-group transactions, we need to eliminate them. Now, previously we learned that anytime we have to do consolidation, we may be given a balance sheet instance or we may have an income statement instance. I'm going to start off with a balance sheet situation. With a balance sheet situation, we are interested in knowing whether there's been some profit that has been wrongly recognized. Wrongly recognized because before the group will say a profit is recognized, it means that the goods have been sold to parties who are outside the group. So long as the parties are within the group, even though sales may have been made within the group, such profits in those sales will not be. When it comes to intra-group transactions like we are seeing currently, there are normally two different types of items we are likely to be encountering. The first is when we transact in trading stock, like parent sells goods to sub or subsidiary sells goods to parents, or it could be transfer. It could be transfer of non-current assets. Like parent sells a motor vehicle to subsidiary, or subsidiary sells a motor vehicle to parents. Now let's first look at trading stock. So when it comes to sale of goods within the group, let's assume that parents sold goods to subsidiary. The value of those goods is given as 300,000. Now the question is, did parents include some profits in this 300,000 sales? If parents did include profits, what is the amount of the profit? Let's assume that these goods were sold at a markup of say 25%. It could be margin, it could be markup. And you know the principles of markup margin, right? At the end of the day, markup and margin represents profit. But the basis of computing that profit is what defines it as a markup or a margin. Markup is defined as profit expressed as a percentage on cost, whereas margin is defined as profit expressed as a percentage on selling price. So what I normally do is I put up cost plus profit is equal to selling price. It's a simple pricing policy, right? Cost plus profit is equal to selling price. Since markup and margin are other names for profit, I will always be giving that in the question. So for instance, in my illustration, I said markup is 25%. So it means that profit, which is called markup or margin, is given as 25%. The next question I'll ask is, how is this profit defined? Is it defined as a markup in the question or is it defined as a margin? In my illustration, it is defined as a markup. If it is a markup, then we know the definition for markup. Markup is profit expressed as a percentage on cost. The basis of computing the profit is always equal to the denominator or 100. In our case, because it is 25%, so we are equating it to 100. So since it is a markup situation, then the profit is on cost. So I'll put my 100 here. If it was margin, then the profit will be on selling price. So then I'll put my 100 here. Since this is a markup situation I'm dealing with, it is profit 25 expressed as a percentage on cost. So I'll put my 100 here. C plus P is equal to SP. So it means SP will be 125. If the same thing I was expressing it as a margin, then I would say C plus P is equal to SP. Assuming that my illustration says, oh, the goods were sold to S for 300,000 at a margin of 25%. Margin is also profit, just as markup is a profit. So I'll put my 25 under profit. But since it is margin, this profit is expressed as a percentage on selling price, because margin is profit expressed as a percentage of selling price. The basis of computing your profit would always be equated to 100. So profit expressed as a percentage on selling price, then I'll put my 100 here. So if it's a margin, cost plus profit is equal to this. Since this is 100, it means this one will be equal to 75. So this is a margin situation. And that is a markup situation. The same 25%, the name given to it would influence the way you compute it. If it is called markup, you put the 100 under the C or under cost. If it is called margin, you put the 100 under SP. But the formula still works, so you just have to find your missing figure. Now that is just by the way. So what it means is that I have a markup of 25%. So I'm going to calculate the profit that is contained in the 300,000. With my price structure here, anytime I pick a value, I will ask whether it represents cost, profit, or selling price. And I'll divide it by the related percentage. So we are giving the value of the goods to be 300,000. This 300,000 represents the selling price. So I will divide by 125. And I want profit, which is equal to 25. So it means that the profits included in the 300,000 is equal to 60,000. So parent has sold 300,000 worth of goods to subsidiary, including a profit of 300,000. Now this in itself is not an issue. It becomes an issue only when subsidiary is unable to sell all the 300,000 worth of goods to the public. If subsidiary by the end of the year, if by the time we are consolidating, subsidiary has been able to sell all the goods to the public, then we'll say the 60,000 profit is all realized. The 60,000 profit will all be realized only when the 300,000 worth of goods are entirely sold to the public by subsidiary. So long as part of the 300,000 remains in the inventory of subsidiary, part of the profit content in those goods would be considered as unrealized profit. So to calculate the unrealized profit, the next question I'll be asking myself is, how much of the 300,000 goods are still in the inventory of subsidiary. So I would say unrealized profits is equal to the percentage of unsold goods, right, applied on the profits. So for instance, assuming that our question tells us that, oh, of the 300,000, only 40% of it had been sold by a subsidiary. If 40% are sold by a subsidiary, it means that 60% of those goods are still in the inventory of subsidiary. What it also means is that then 60% of the total profit of 60,000 is not yet recognized or is not yet realized. So that is what we call unrealized profit. So to calculate my unrealized profit, since I say 40% has been sold, I would say 60%, which is the unsold percentage of our goods, times the total profit on the goods, which is 60,000. So that gives us 36,000. So there is a provision for unrealized profit of 36,000. There is 36,000 contained in the value of goods that has been sold by parent to subsidiary, which is not yet realized because subsidiary couldn't sell all the 300,000 worth of goods to the public. If subsidiary sells all the 300,000 goods to the public before consolidation, then we say the entire 60,000 is realized. So there wouldn't be a need to do a provision for unrealized profits. Now, the next thing we have to look at is this 36,000, how would you treat it? The 36,000 provision for unrealized profits would have to be taken away from the consolidated income surplus. The question is, should we apportion the 36,000 between NCI and parents? As to whether you apportioned your provision for unrealized profit between parents and NCI would depend on who sold the goods. All the time, you look out for who is selling the goods and, for that matter, who is making the profit. If parents is the one selling the goods, it means that parents is the one that is recognizing the profit. If parents recognizes profit, that is wrong. If parents recognizes profit that is not supposed to be realized, parents' profit in total will be wrong. If parents' profit in total is wrong, does it have any impact on NCI? The answer is no. So long as NCI is not affected by the misstatements or miscalculation of parents' profits, any unrealized profits made by parents will not be allocated. Portion of it will not be allocated to NCI. So what this means is that when parents sells to subsidiary, the unrealized profit should not be allocated to NCI. So when parents sells goods to subsidiary, and for that matter, parents is making some profit, if part of those goods are not sold, fully sold to the public yet, and for that matter, we are calculating unrealized profit, will not give some of that unrealized profit to NCI because parents' profit is misstated, and when parents' profit is misstated, NCI is not. The second instance is when sub sells to parents. Now let's look at, even with the same illustration here, assuming that the 300,000 worth of goods were actually sold by a subsidiary to parents, how would the computation be done? Essentially, the computations would be the same like we have done. You know, if it is markup, we are going to apply 25 over 125 times 300. We'll get a total profit of 60,000. Then, if part of the goods are sold, we'll look out for the portion that is unsold, and then we'll calculate the unrealized profit on it. So, assuming that still 40% of the goods have been sold by parents to the public, so it means that 60% are still being kept by parents in their inventory. So calculate 60% of 60,000, which gives us 36,000, and that 36,000 is the unrealized profit. Now this is a profit that is not yet realized, but then it has been recognized by a subsidiary. Subsidiary has included this 36,000 as part of its total profit because they sold the goods. And the moment they sold the goods, they recognize the profit. So what it means is that subsidiary's profit is wrong. A subsidiary's profit is wrong. It has been overstated by 36,000. Who is impacted by this amount of overstatement? Anytime profits of subsidiary is misstated, it affects parents and it also affects NCI. Because the profit of subsidiary belongs to parents and it belongs to what? NCI. In fact, in our illustration, 80% belongs to parents and 20% belongs to NCI. The unrealized profit, 80% of it would be given to parents and 20% to NCI. The total unrealized profit is 36,000, so I'll just multiply this by 36,000 and multiply that one too by 36,000. 80% of 36,000 will give us 28,800. 20% of that will give us 7,200. So what we've effectively done is anytime subsidiary sells goods and recognizes profits on those goods, that is when they sell goods to parent, and there is a profit loaded in that goods, the portion that is unsold, right, will represent, will calculate the unrealized profit of that. And that unrealized profit will have to be splitted between parents and NCI. The reason why we are splitting is because anytime subsidiary's profit is misstated, parent is affected and NCI is also affected. If, on the other way around, parent sells goods to subsidiary, it means that parent is the one recognizing the unrealized profit. So parent's profit is misstated. Anytime parent's profit is misstated, it doesn't have any impact on NCI. So we will not give part of parent's unrealized profit to NCI. Now, once these figures have been computed, what do we do? Of course, the 28,800 will be written off to consolidated income surplus. The 7,200 will be written off to the NCI account. You remember we paid the NCI account when we were looking at valuation of NCI, both under proportion of net asset method and in the fair value method. In either instance, whether it is proportion of net asset method or fair value method, you would have to send the unrealized profits attributable to NCI to that account. In fact, unrealized profit is actually a loss, it's a deduction, so it will have to be deducted from the value of NCI. In the same vein, the unrealized profit that belongs to the parent will be sent to the consolidated income surplus and will be deducted from the consolidated income surplus, essentially debited to the consolidated income surplus. The next thing to look at is the valuation of determination of intragroup transaction using assets. Now, assuming that we have a second instance where there's been intragroup transaction, but this time it is not sale of goods. Maybe parents transferred a non-current asset to subsidiary. So let's assume that parents sold a motor vehicle to SAP at a value of 100,000. So parent is selling a motor vehicle valued at 100,000. And this one is at a margin. This time, let me use a margin. It is at a margin of, say, 20%, right? If it is at a margin of 20%, I'll still do my cost plus profit is equal to selling price 10. And profit is given as 20, but this profit is calculated on sales because it's margin. A margin is profit expressed as a percentage on sales. So I put my 100 here, meaning that cost is equal to 80. What this means is that for the 100,000 value, I'll divide by 100 and multiply by 20, which is 20,000. This means that there is a profit of 20,000 included in the asset. Now, since by the end of the year, the asset has not been sold subsequently by subsidiary to the public, it means that there is an unrealized profit of 20,000 included in the value of the asset. So the original cost of the asset is 20,000 from 100,000. So 100,000 minus 20,000. That will give us the original cost of the asset. So let's see original cost is equal to 100,000 minus 20,000, which is equal to 80,000. Now, what has happened? What happened is that the parents sold the assets for 100,000, making a profit of 20,000. Subsidiary bought the asset for 100,000. So, subsidiary is going to recognize the 100,000 as its cost. So, when subsidiary is classifying its assets, it's going to include 100,000 among its PP&E schedule as part of what? The cost of the asset. But we know that that 100,000 contains profits. On consolidation, the profit will have to be eliminated because as a group, we can't recognize the assets with the profits contained included. You know, so what we're going to do is we are going to make a provision for unrealized profit of 20,000. Again, we'll be asking the question, should we apportion the provision of 20,000 and give part to NCI and give part to our parents? The answer is, who is recognizing the profit? Who is making the profit? If parent is the one making the profit, you don't split, because then it is parent's profit that is wrong. So you don't have to split. If NCI, if subsidiary is the one making the profit, they have to split it between parents and NCI, like we saw under the Boo situation. The only other thing that comes with transfer of non-parent assets is when the asset in question is depreciable. So when you are dealing with a depreciable asset, then what it means is that the buying party, the party that is buying, whether it's parents that is buying the asset or the subsidiary that is buying the asset, is going to subject the assets to depreciation. Let's assume that our asset is depreciated at the rate of 10%. Then what it means is that, since I'm saying subsidiary the one that bought the goods, subsidiary is going to subject the 100,000 value at a rate of 10%. So they would have calculated this one times 100,000. They will say our annual depreciation is 10,000. So this is their annual depreciation. But what we also know is that the 100,000 is actually not the cost of the asset. Depreciation is supposed to be provided on the cost of the asset of 80,000. But we've provided depreciation on the value of 100,000, which contains profits. So what do? We'll have to look out for what the correct amount is. So they were supposed to have calculated 10% on 80,000, which is 8,000, right? So let me call it correct depreciation. But they calculated it on 10,000. What it means is that depreciation has been overstated by 2,000. So this is overstatement. So depreciation has been overstated by 2,000 as a result of valuing the asset with profit included, right? Another way of calculating this over depreciation is to say depreciation rates calculated on the unrealized profit of 20,000. So we can calculate 10% of the 20,000, which will still give us 2,000. And this is the amount of over depreciation. Now, who is over depreciating? In our instance here, I'm saying that parent is the one selling the asset. So if parent is the one selling, then it means that subsidiary bought their asset and provided a depreciation on 100,000 when they were supposed to have provided depreciation on 80,000. What it means is that subsidiary is the one who is over depreciating. If subsidiary is over depreciating, then it means that subsidiary's profit has been understated. Once profits of subsidiary is understated or misstated, who is impacted? Part of subsidiary's profit goes to parents and part goes to NCI. So what it means is that the amount of over-depreciation will have to be split between NCI and parents. So we say, okay, then let's give to parents an amount of 80% of that 2,000. Then let's give to NCI 20% of the 2,000. So this gives me 1,600 and that gives me 400. Because parent is the one selling, parent recognizes profit, which is an unrealized profit. That unrealized profit would be entirely debited to the consolidated income surplus. Will not give some to NCI because parent's profit is not, does not affect NCI. But once the asset is depreciable, you ask the question, who is over depreciating? If subsidiary is the one over depreciating because they are the one who bought the asset, then it means that subsidiary's profit is misstated because over depreciation results in understatement of profit. So then you will have to share the amount of over depreciation between parent and NCI. If on the other way around, subsidiary sells the assets to the parent, then subsidiary will be recognizing an unrealized profit, which will have to be shared between parents and NCI in their respective proportion. But the amount of depreciation, the amount of over depreciation will not be apportioned between parents and NCI. It will be given entirely to parents because it is parents that will be over depreciating. With the instance here, this is over depreciation. If it is over depreciation, to correct it, we would have to add it back to our profit. So what we'll do is that we'll go and add this to consolidated income surplus. And then we'll go and add this to the non-controlling interest accounts. Why are we adding? We are adding because we see the effect of this is that subsidiary's profit has been understated. If subsidiary's profit has been understated, they mean that the respective amount that has been shared between parents and NCI has also been understated. So we are adding the amount by which the depreciation or there is over depreciation to the amount of each of these particular parties. So parents is going to get 1,600 added to its surplus in consolidated income surplus. So NCI is going to get 400 added to its account in the NCI account. And you do this whether you are dealing with a proportion of net assets method of valuing NCI or you are dealing with the fair value method of valuing NCI.